well, a pleasant day, children. I'm sure you must be very eager to learn the new lesson for the day, which is fiber to fabric. Now let's begin with the introduction. Clothes are worn according to the climatic condition of any place. For example, in summer, we wear cotton clothes that are good absorbers of sweat and make us feel comfortable, isn't it? In rainy season, we use raincoats, rubber boots, and umbrellas to prevent ourselves from getting wet. Wow, how lovely is the rain, isn't it? We are all just waiting for rain, I guess. Okay, similarly, in winter, we wear thick woolen clothes to keep our body warm. Different types of clothes are made from different fibers. You have learned about the different types of fibers in the previous class, haven't you? Yes. You now know that fibers are of two types, that is the natural and man-made. Natural fibers are also of two types, that is the plant fiber like the cotton and jute, and animal fibers like wool and silk. There are different types of animal fibers. We will study about the animal fibers in this chapter. Wow! I'm just waiting to learn about the animal fibers now. As the name suggests, animal fibers are derived from different animals. They are of mainly two types, wool and silk. Wool is obtained from animals such as sheep, goat, camel, yak. These wool-yielding animals bear wool as hair on their body. Silk is another animal fiber obtained from silkworm. So, where do we get silk from? Silk is from silkworm. And where do we get wool from? We get it from the sheep, from the goat, from camels and yaks. Well, let's begin with the wool now. This is wool, children. This is how the wool looks. Wool is the soft, thick hair which grows on the bodies of sheep and some other animals. Air gets trapped in the air spaces between the hair and keep the animals warm in cold weather. The main source of wool is sheep, although it is also obtained from goats, camels, yaks and llamas. The thick covering of wool on a sheep is called fleece. What is a thick covering of wool on a sheep called? Fleece. Okay. It is of two types. One is soft under the hair part, which is close to the skin. Another is the hard upper hair part. Usually the under hair part is used to prepare soft wool. Wool is generally creamy white in color, although some breeds of sheep produce natural colors such as black, brown, silver, and random mixes. Lovely, isn't it? So beautiful. I would love to, play with some wool. What about you? Okay, let's come back to the point. Animals that yield wool. The people started domesticating sheep from around 10,000 BC. They learned the technique of getting wool from sheepskin about 5,000 years later. There are different types of wool available in the market. They are of different quality and price. The quality of wool is determined by various factors like fiber diameter, color, fiber and strength. Fiber diameter is the most important wool characteristic which determines quality and price. The finest and the most valuable wool comes from the Merino, a breed of sheep from Spain. Okay, these are the breed of sheep from Spain. They look beautiful, don't they? On an average, a sheep produces about 2 to 30 pounds of wool annually. The amount of wool that a sheep produces depends on its breed, nutrition and shearing interval. Lambs, that is the young sheep, produce less wool than the mature animals. Due to their larger size, rams, that is the adult male sheep, usually produce more wool than the ewes, that is the adult female sheep of the same age and breed. Okay, now coming to India, has different types of climate in different regions. All types of climate do not suit all breeds of sheep. Hence, different breeds exist in different regions as mentioned in the table 3.1. Now let's see. This is the breeds of sheep. This is the use of wool. States where they are found. Now this is Lohi. This is good quality wool. And where do we get it? In Rajasthan and Punjab. This is Rampur bush hair. Now this is a brown fleece in Uttar Pradesh and Himachal Pradesh. This is Nali. That's carpet wool. And where is it? In Rajasthan, Haryana, Punjab. And this is Bakarwal for woolen shawls in Jammu and Kashmir. Marwari coarse wool, Gujarat. Patanwali for hosiery, that's in Gujarat. Okay, so these are some of the Indian breeds of sheep giving us different sorts of wool. Okay, although sheep wool is the most available wool in the market, wools from other animals are also popular. Here we have yak wool. Yak is a type of cattle with long hair and long horn. They are found mainly in Tibet. Yak wool is popular in Tibet and Ladakh. Angora wool. This is obtained from Angora goats or rabbits found in the hilly regions of Jammu and Kashmir. Angora wool is extremely soft, warm and fluffy. The fiber from Angora goat is called mohair. Mohair is famous for its light weight, warmth and durability. This wool is especially used to prepare sweaters and soft coverings for furniture. Then we are having here cashmere wool. The wool obtained from the bellies of cashmere goat, as in figure 3.4 over here, which is found in Tibet and China, is called the cashmere wool. The wool is one of the most expensive, extremely soft and easy to dye. Now coming to the camel wool. The fur on the body of the camels, this is a camel here, is also used as wool. This wool is sometimes left in its original color because of its natural beauty. Let's go further. Here we have the llama and this is a alpaca. Are the animals of camel family and are found in South America. They also yield wool which is soft and warm. Now let's begin with the activity number one. What is it? Draw an outline map of India and mark these places where you can find animals that provide wool. Use different colors to denote the location for different wool yielding animals. Share the map with your class. Now children, this is the map that you're going to draw on your own. And you're going to use different colors to denote the location of different wool yielding animals. And I want everybody to do it. Okay. Now we come to activity 2. Collect different fibers from your surroundings and classify them as animal or plant or artificial fibers. Take the help of your teacher to identify the fiber. Now extraction of wool. The process of turning wool into fabric has several steps that have been refined with time. Wool production includes the following steps. Now let's go to the steps, that is shearing, scoring, sorting, combining, making yarn. Okay, now let's see how is the process. The process of removing wool from the body of the sheep is called shearing. Shearing of a sheep is done annually. Very sharp blades are unclosed to the sheepskin for removing the coat of wool. Sometimes the sheep are washed before shearing to pull out some of the natural lanolin and to remove large pieces of debris. The shearer tries as far as possible to remove the fur in one piece without harming the animal. And then we come to scoring. This process involves washing the sheared wool thoroughly with soap water to remove all unwanted and greasy material. This wool is then dried and passed through the rollers. Then we have sorting. Now the wool is divided into sections and graded based on their quality. Wool of the same quality is processed together to obtain different types of textiles. Combining. The sorting process is followed by combining, in which the wool is combined to pull the fibers into alignment and to remove chunks of material which may be caught in it. Combed wool is then run through very fine wire brushes to line the fibers up. Pull out short segments and give the fibers their final shape and direction. Making yarn. Let's go making the yarn. The fibers are then spun into threads or yarn for weaving, crocheting or knitting. The width of the finished thread depends on how it is handled during spinning. The quality of wool depends on the breed of the sheep, and it is then decided on the basis of thickness, length, strength, color, and the shine of the wool. Children, now as we are talking about the wool, I would love you all to venture into knitting. See, out of wool, that's knitting, where we make sweaters and all that. Even crochet, I just love crochet. It's something which you do with one needle only. And everybody can do it, irrespective whether you're a boy or a girl. But it's a very, very, you know, good thing to learn. If I were given the chance, I would learn it again and again. Okay? You can even go in for weaving, but it would be great for you, rather than going into knitting, to go into crochet. You can make lovely bags, lovely purses, and lovely mobile pouches. Once you start doing crochet, you will go gaga over it. Let me tell you that. Okay, this is the process here. The sheep are sheared to remove the fleece. Then the fleece is baled for transport to the mill. Then the fleece is washed in the mills to remove the dirt. Then carding machine combs the loose wool fibers into sheet. After that, the sheet is twisted with a rope called sliver. Then the sliver is stretched and twisted into a thin yarn. After that, the yarn is wound to form balls of wool. Such a lengthy process, isn't it? So I want, once again, I'm encouraging you to learn crochet. It's a lovely art. Now we come to silk. Silk fiber is also an animal fiber. Silk is one of the highly paid and prized fibers because of its shining luster. It is a good fabric for both winters and summers due to its heat resistant nature. The life cycle of a silkworm begins when a female silk moth lays eggs. After about 20 days, the larva or caterpillars start hatching from these eggs. Then they are known as silkworms or caterpillars. These silkworms feed on fresh mulberry leaves and grow in size. They secrete fine filaments from the glands on their heads. These filaments are made up of a protein which hardens to form silk fibers when exposed to air. Lovely information, na, children? Okay. The silkworm deposits filaments in a number of concentric layers around its body through figure of eight movements of the head. This results in the formation of a structure called the cocoon. In about 3 to 7 days, inside the cocoon, the silkworm enters a second stage of its life called the pupa and develops into a moth. In nature, this life cycle occurs once a year, but under experimental setup, it can occur up to 3 times in a year. Now, this is a life cycle of a silk moth. All right, year. This is how it goes over here. All right. The caterpillars come out of the eggs. Then the caterpillar feed on mulberry leaves. Caterpillars spin cocoon around themselves. Caterpillar change into pupae. The pupae, this is the pupae here. Pupae is changed to adult moth. And again it goes on and on. And the moth lays eggs. It is an ongoing process, children. Okay? So, this is the life cycle of a silk moth. I want you to draw it. Alright? Now, let's see what this Do You Know has in store for us. The Central Silk Board, a statutory body under the Government of India, is a national organization responsible for overall development of sericulture and silk industry in India. It was established in 1949 and its headquarters are located in Bengaluru. That's in the south, okay, south of India. Now, and Bengaluru also is the capital of Karnataka. The production of silk, the raising of silkworms in order to obtain silk for commercial purposes is called sericulture. So, if anybody asks you what is sericulture, what must you say? The raising of silkworms in order to obtain silk for commercial purposes is called sericulture. Production of silk is a slow and gradual process. There are many species of silkworm that can produce silk, but among them, Bombyx mori is the most widely used. The silk is a continuous filament. The silk is a continuous filament fiber consisting of a protein called fibroin and a gum called sericin. Fibroin prepares the silk filaments and sericin cements the two filaments together. The sericin is removed by placing the cocoons in hot water. This process frees silk filaments and prepares them for reeling. The stages involved in silk production are given below. The silk moth, that is the Bombyx mori, lays eggs on a mulberry tree. The eggs hatch into caterpillars, that is silkworms. They are fed chopped mulberry leaves, okay, for 20 to 25 days. When the silkworms are about 25 days old, they become 10,000 times heavier than their first stage. They are now ready to spin a silk cocoon. Silk is produced from silkworm's head and then forced out into a liquid form through openings called spinnerets. The silk solidifies when it comes to contact with air. The silkworm completes its cocoon, which is about 4 centimeters. Now, these are the mulberry leaves which are chopped and given to the silkworms. Got it? Okay. 4 centimeters long in about 5 days by producing 600 to 1200 meters of silk filament. Can you imagine this many meters of silk filament? The cocoons are then put in hot water. Now this is very sad. To kill the worms as well as loosens the filaments. Some cocoons are preserved to get silkworms that can be used later for breeding. A single cocoon contains approximately 1,000 yards of silk filament. Now this is quite a big, a huge expanse of silk, isn't it? The silk at this stage is known as raw silk. The filaments from several cocoons are reeled off together to prepare a continuous strong thread. Just one thread consists of 48 individual silk filaments. Finally, the threads are dried and the raw silk is reeled and packed according to quality. Look at the silkworms. Children, I want you to, surf the net for more information on silkworms, okay? Have a look at the, you may get some lovely YouTube, short clips also based on this procedure. Kindly have a look at it, okay? Now let's see what the Do You Know has in store for us. Sericulture has become one of the most important cottage industries in a number of countries like China, Republic of Korea, Japan, India, Brazil, Russia, Italy and France. Today, China and India are the two main producers that contribute to more than 60% of the silk in the world each year. Now let's see the properties of silk fiber. Silk has many qualities that sets it apart. From the other fibers. Silk is lustrous and can be dyed to different colors. As silk can absorb moisture, we feel comfortable wearing silk dresses. Silk is not affected by water, although detergents and perspiration can break down its fibers. Although what can break down its fibers, children? Detergents and perspiration. Okay. Silk garments are light in weight and keep us warm. Silk garments can be worn both in summer and in winter. Silk threads are as strong as steel wires of the same diameter. Can you imagine that? Moreover, because of its elastic nature, silk can be combined and knitted with other fibers like wool to prepare beautiful garments. How lovely is this material? Silk fabrics, can you imagine that? Now let's see the health hazards in silk and wool industry. In India, many people earn their livelihood from wool and silk industries. But when workers employed in these industries get adversely affected by many health problems and diseases, some of the serious health problems are discussed below. Sorters' job in wool industry is risky as sometimes they get infected by a bacterium called anthrax, which causes a fatal blood disease called sorters' disease. Goodness me, that's very, very serious disease. Okay, children, let's go further. The workers dip the cocoons for long hours in boiling water to extract silk strand. As a result of this, their skin becomes raw and blistered. This must be certainly painful, isn't it? The silk industry workers inhale vapors arising from cocoons in boiling water. Also during reeling, a lot of fiber and other things are inhaled by them. This results in health problems like asthma, bronchial allergies and related ailments. The handling of dead silkworms with bare hands leads to various infections and illnesses. The workers in weaving industry are exposed to noise made by spinning and winding machines and looms. This results in hearing disorders. Working in poorly ventilated and damp rooms causes various respiratory problems. Children, as I am reading this health hazards, if you go to see, their condition is really, really pathetic, isn't it? I mean, just to give us the best, they are toiling so much and their health is at a risk. Got it? Although research workers are carried out all over the world to develop silk and wool industries, that is, once again, although research works are carried out all over the world to develop silk and wool industries, very little has been done to improve the working conditions of the laborers of these industries. The health professionals should find out the possible means in this regard. It is a must for the health professionals to do something about this, because it's a really, really a very big serious problem. Now let's go to the history of sericulture. Once upon a time, there lived Queen Zilang, wife of Emperor Wang Di. What was the name of the queen, children? Zilang. What was her name? Zilang. And whose wife was she? She was the wife of Emperor Wang Di in the ancient kingdom of China. The queen was interested in the art of weaving. One day, she was sitting in the garden under a mulberry tree, sipping a favorite drink tea. Suddenly, something fell into her cup. The queen jumped and spilled the tea all over a beautiful dress. Her courtiers rushed to wipe off the stains, but the queen stopped them. On the top of the tea stain on her dress, she noticed a bright web of exquisite threads she had never seen before. Picking up the delicate threads, she felt them soft and smooth to touch. This is how the process of extracting silk was discovered. So children, this is an interesting story and it's a fact. It's a fact, okay? So this is how the silk, extracting of silk was discovered. So the silk industry began in China and was kept a closely guarded secret for hundreds of years. Later on, the rest of the world came to know about the process and production and usage of silk spread far and wide. So that's how we are enjoying a lot of silk cloth nowadays. Got it, children? Now let's see what is Do You Know has in store for us. The silk route was the most well-known trading route of the ancient Chinese civilization. It connected East, South and West Asia with the North and Northeast, Africa and Europe, as well as the Mediterranean world. The Silk Route was an important path of cultural and technological transmission that linked traders, pilgrims, missionaries, soldiers and common people of China, India, Persia and Mediterranean countries for almost 3,000 years. Children, that was something interesting, wasn't it? Okay, now let's go to the points to remember. Silk and wool are animal fibers. Sheep are reared for getting wool. Sheep hair is sheared off from the body of a sheep to yield wool. The hairs of camel, llama, and alpaca are also processed to yield wool. Silkworms are the caterpillars of silk moth. During their life cycle, the silkworms spin cocoons of silk fiber. Now, silk fibers are made from a protein called fibroin. So, the silk fibers are made of protein called fibroin. Silk fibers are taken out from the cocoon and reeled into silk threads. Workers employed in silk and wool industries get adversely affected by many health problems and diseases. So that was about the points to remember. Now let's go further on to the important definitions. Now what is a cocoon? A cocoon is a protective shield of silk fiber made by silk moth. What is fleece? Fleece is a thick covering of wool on a sheep. What is shearing? Shearing is the process of removing wool off a sheep. What is scoring? Scoring is washing sheared wool with water to remove all unwanted and greasy material. What is sorting? Sorting is dividing the wool as per its quality. Then what is reeling? Reeling is obtaining silk from cocoon. What is sericulture? Sericulture is the raising of silkworms in order to obtain silk. So children, that's the end of the story of the lesson, Fiber to Fabric. I hope you had a lovely time on this journey with the lesson, Fiber to Fabric. Have a lovely day and a big God bless and thank you.